invite you to continue to have free reign and be glorified. We just thank you, Lord. Have free reign this morning. You might be struggling with today, okay? As you sing about breaking chains, just turn it over to God this morning. And if you don't have an addiction, you might have a loved one, a friend, you know someone that's struggling with something in their lives, amen? And as we sing Break Every Chain, just turn it over to God and allow Him to break those chains this morning. Amen, church? Here we go.
Break every chain. covenant of old, and your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I say your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Ooh, yeah.
Come on, church, sing it out. It's so beautiful.
You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole, and you shoulder the weakness, and your strength becomes our own, and you're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes, for you will have your bride.
thank you, Father. Lord, I love this song. I love these lyrics because we get to decide. We get to decide what our lips will say, Lord God, where our focus will be. And this morning, Lord God, we focus on you and our lips bring you praise, Father. Lord, we turn away from all of the worries. Lord, we turn away from all of the stress, from all of the weight that we've carried in here, Lord, and we look to you, our Father. Lord, and our lips bring you praise. I'm reminded that Jesus said that if the people don't praise me, the rocks will cry out. And this morning here, we are saying that no rock will cry out in our place, Lord, but we will praise you in this place, Lord. Lord, and I am just reminded of all that you have done, Lord. All that you've done in my life, Lord. All that you've done in the lives of the people gathered here, Lord, of your sons and your daughters, Father. But I know that there is someone here, Lord, many people here who are saying, why, God? Why am I walking through this? Why am I facing this? Why are my children dealing with this, Lord? Why have you given us this heavy burden? And so, Lord, we lift them up as brothers and sisters in Christ. We lift them up to you, Lord God. And we just pray the peace that surpasses all understanding, Lord, would be with them this morning, Lord. Father, that your hand would be upon those who are tired, those who are weary, those who are weak in this place, Lord. That you would be bringing answers to questions, Lord, that you would be bringing peace where there is none, Lord, that you would be bringing your grace and your truth, Lord, into situations that need that. And so, Father, it all comes full circle. We just turn away from those things and turn toward you, our Father, the one who loves us and holds us in the very palm of his hand. And so we thank you for it. We thank you for all that you are doing today. This morning is yours. This time is yours. We are expecting great things, Lord God. We just pray that you would speak to our hearts, Lord God, that you'd speak through Pastor, that those words would continue to bring life, Lord, not only to us, but to our families, to this community, Lord, as we are sent out. And we thank you for it. We thank you for all that you're doing. We pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Let's have a seat. We're going to watch a video together.
Pretty women wonder where my secret lies. I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model size. But when I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say, it's in the reach of my arms, the span of my hips, the stride of my step, the curl of my lips. I'm a woman.
And I'm a believer.
Phenomenal woman. That's us.
Because of them, we can.
Good morning, church. How are you guys doing? Good. Well, I am super excited because this morning we get to do one of my favorite things, and it is Serve for Sunday. So we are going to honor and highlight someone who serves here so faithfully at the church. And I think I say this every time, but it's really true. I am so excited about who we get to honor today. She is an incredible woman of God, and if I could think about one word to describe her, I think that it would be faithful. And so this morning, let's give it up for Jasmine Sandy. And let's watch a video together.
Children to understand that Jesus loves them and that he cares about them. Joseph, say hi to Joseph.
Hi, Joseph.
Hi, Jacob. Hi, Jeremy. Hi, Kiana. Hi, Zoe. Hi, Quincy.
Hi.
Come on up here, Jasmine. She looks beautiful today. Every day, but today I love this outfit. I think that I speak for all of the parents in the room who have their children in the room with you. We love you, and we're so thankful to you. I said in first service that my kids come home, and they are singing songs that I don't know about God, and I'll say, where did you learn that? Oh, we learned that from Miss Jasmine. And I have just seen over and over and over again, one, your faithfulness, but also I just see that you have been called by God to work with these children, and you don't take that lightly. You take it so seriously, and you are so faithful to what God has called you to do. And so we are so thankful for you, so much so that we want to send you on a date night with Winston. So, yeah. Did you want to say anything real quick?
I just want to say thanks to Innovation for giving me these opportunities. It has been about 7 years now working with the children, and I don't take that lightly, because not only that I teach them, but I also learn from the lessons that I have taught. And I encourage everyone who is here who wants to participate in a ministry. There are many ministries for you to participate in. For the children, we have four different classes. We have the nursery, we have the toddlers, we have the preschoolers, and also the upper grade, which is kindergarten through sixth grade. We lack staff members, so we are encouraging that you participate in this, because right now we kind of alternate per Sundays, and there's one person who teaches every first service, which we do need assistance. So, ladies and gentlemen, young and old, we welcome you. Thank you again.
Thank you, Jasmine. I love it. She did the plug for me. So if you want to serve with the kids, please. Thank you, Jasmine. On the back of your Connect card, there's a little bubble that says, send me information about serving at Innovation. Fill it out. We would love for you to come in and work with the kids.
All right. How's everybody doing? Doing well. Glad to have you all with us at Innovation. We're glad that you chose to come and join with us and worship with us this morning. I've had a blast so far. First service was great. Second service, you guys are doing so. So, you know, we'll step it up from here. I'm just kidding. You guys are the best. If you don't know me and you're wondering why I have the microphone, my name is Josh. I'm one of the teaching pastors here at the church. And like I said, I do just want to welcome you. And I would love to draw your attention to the bulletin that you received on your way in. And please pull out the Connect card that you'll find inside each and every one of those bulletins. I would love it if you would just write your name on that Connect card for us, and you can put it in the offering bucket when it goes by later in the service. But you can put more than just your name. If you think we don't maybe have your correct home phone or cell phone or email or any of those fun things, please put it on there. We're in the middle of updating our database. That would help us incredibly. And of course, if it's your first time here, maybe your second time, write your address on there. Let us know how we can get in touch with you, how we could reach you. We'd love to send you a little gift in the mail, a thank you from us to you again, just to let you know that we do value you, your time, and your choice to come and worship with us at Innovation Church. So thank you for doing that. I'm not going to go over everything that's in the bulletin today. You'll see there are several flyers regarding an upcoming sign language class, a couple upcoming adult classes, a Bible discussion group that'll be starting on Sunday mornings next Sunday, a Wednesday group with Pastor Charles talking about intercession coming up on Wednesdays in the next couple of weeks. You can check out the bulletin for those items. I'm not going to talk too much about them, but we do have, of course, this evening, starting at 5 o'clock, our Black History Celebration, which I think is going to be an incredibly fun night. It's going to be awesome with some great music and some prayer and some great talks here from the stage. But then after that, from 5 to 6, we'll be here, and then at 6, we're going to go into the fellowship hall, and I encourage everyone to bring some really, really, really good food to share so we can have a dinner together and just hang out and be the church. Amen? So I hope you'll all be back. Anybody coming? Who's planning on being here tonight? Let me see you coming. All right. A lot of you are going to be there. It's going to be a great time, so hopefully we'll see you all back tonight again at 5 o'clock. And let's see. Oh, I wanted to mention Outbreak. They have their Hershey Convention coming up in April. So we have a little ways to go, but the kids, of course, are starting to sign up and fill out their registration. It's $150 for the three-day weekend for them to go and have an incredible time. There are tens of thousands of youth that fill this stadium, and they just seek God and worship God together. It's a powerful event for them, so I hope that you would consider going. If you're a youth or a parent of youth, send them. And if you want to sponsor a kid, you know, who maybe couldn't afford to have that weekend away for $150, you can sponsor some. We've had two sponsorships come in already. We'd love to have more, so you can mark that on your check or giving envelope, and we'll make sure that it goes to a kid who really wants to and deserves to go. I think actually John is using some of the sponsorships as motivation with an Outbreak, right? He's doing activities and things where these kids are working and dedicating and seeking God, and he's rewarding them in a way with some of the generosity here in the church, which is a really cool thing to be able to do. I want to introduce a video that we're going to watch here in just a moment. Like I said, we're updating our database, so we got all this new information, and we want your participation with this information. It's going to be available to you as a directory. I want to show a video to you about that, as well as a new app that we're just launching as a church, because we're called Innovation Church. We got to have an app, right? Like, we're way behind the curve on the app game. So check this out, and then Pastor Charles will be up in just a moment.
Hi, everyone. This week, Innovation Church is introducing a new online church directory and church app. And we want to invite you to participate in the directory and the church app. And what we're going to do is this week we'll be sending an email to everyone that has a link that will get you right onto the page where you can put in your personal information. However, we need you to take your Connect card today and make sure we have your most current email. So when we send you this information, you'll be able to get right onto the new church directory and put all the information in for your own page. Let me show you what your page of the directory will look like. You'll have basic information section, an area for education and work, a contact area, an area where you can give skills and giftings and personal experience, and even an area where you can let us know how you heard about Innovation Church. Also, let me show you what the new app looks like. On it, you'll see a Bible translation, actually many Bible translations, all of our podcasts going back for years. You'll have a place to give online, an area where you can connect with the church, a church calendar that is maintained, and you'll be able to know exactly what's going on here on any given day, and most importantly, an area for prayer requests, both where you can add your own prayer request and look at a prayer wall where you can see what other people are praying about. So I hope you'll take advantage of this new opportunity. We have a church directory that we want you to be a part of, and the new app. We hope that this will be a blessing to you and to your family. I thought I was going to come up to complete silence. I wasn't sure what was about to happen. We really need your most updated email, and even if you think we have it, why don't you just put it on the Connect card today? Not print very legibly, because all of the invitations are going to start going out tomorrow, and they'll continue Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, as we go through our lists and everybody get invited into the directory. Let me just mention that once you have updated your page, you can keep updating it. You can change pictures like Facebook. You can get in there, move things around, and let us know what's going on. Let us know what skills you have and experience and giftings, many things that you can do on your own page. However, when you go look at someone else's page, all you're going to see is their picture and their name. And that, the reason for that is you can pray for them, you can put a face with the name, and but we are keeping it very simple in the rest of the directory. I really hope you'll get those pictures in as soon as you can. It's just a matter of uploading them. You probably all, if you've done Facebook, you know how it's done. It's the same thing. And it would really help me when I'm praying over all of the prayer requests that come in and over this church if I had... I know many of you, but there are some of you, I'm not always sure I hook up a name with the right face or the right children. It would really help if I had those pictures. So if you would do that, that would be awesome. Don't forget to make sure you give us your cell phone number, because our database gets a little confused. Right now we have phone numbers, but if it got put over in a home number, when we send out a text to everybody to let them know that there's an emergency or something we need you to pray about, or the weather change and a service change or a cancellation, and we do it on the text, if we have your text number as a regular church number, you're not going to get it. So, and there's no way we really know, so we encourage you to please let us know what your text phone number is. Even if you think we have it, give it to us again. We'll make sure they all get in the right way so that the database works for you. So we're going to continue with this series. I've been loving it. I hope you've been enjoying it. We're in part 7 of Beyond Book Smart. So let's pray. Father, we come before you now, and we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus, that you would open our hearts and our minds to the Word of God. And as we look into your Word, we pray that your Word would look into us. Give us eyes that see and ears that hear. And we thank you for it, as we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen, amen. So what we've discovered so far, and I hope it's an important discovery for you, is that you can break down the Old Testament and the New Testament into just 4 categories. That's a surprise for some people. You have a prologue, that is what comes first, what sets the stage, what sets up the main story of that Testament, Old Testament or New Testament. Then you have the main event, what that main event is. Then you have the first generation of people who take that main event, run with it, move forward. And then you have the succeeding generation, next generation and others that come after, and what their unique challenges are. We found that to be true in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, we find it to be true as well. And the connection between the main event in both the Old and the New Testaments is the same thing, the Passover and the crossing of the Red Sea, where the Messiah fulfills both through the cross and the resurrection of Christ. Now, the first generation in the New Testament, these are the folks, and in the Old Testament, they were the folks who witnessed, they saw firsthand the power and the supernatural act of God, whether it was the Passover event and the crossing of the Red Sea, and in the New Testament, the crucifixion of Christ and resurrection of Christ. They still feel the fire of God's supernatural act in Jesus. And it's interesting, just as the first generation in the Old Testament was prepared by Joshua, and his Hebrew name is Yeshua, so now in the New Testament, the first generation is prepared by Jesus, whose Hebrew name is Yeshua. So what we have is something that God has brought together very specifically, very uniquely, to explain what has happened in what is without doubt the most important event in the history of the human race. So what we want to do is ask the question, what happened to that first generation of Christians? By the way, this is important because it's the first generation that carries the flame. The second generation, third, fourth, something changes. We'll talk about that next week. It's that first generation that really gets it and is going to move that supernatural event, that the power of God, the purpose of God, forward. And so what happens with the first generation of Christians? Well, first, let me say this, and you have this in your notes as well. They received power. You know, that word power in the New Testament is a Greek word. It's dunamis. It's where we get the word dynamite from, an explosive power, something that breaks through the logjam, something that moves you forward in your life when you feel stuck. How do you get unstuck and move forward? There's power, and the first generation of believers received power, and they received it for two reasons, very important reasons. One is they received the Holy Spirit. They honored and respected the work of the Holy Spirit. After the resurrection of Christ, Jesus appeared to his disciples and many others as well for a course of about 40 days. And there's one appearance to his apostles that's found in John's Gospel. I want to read to you. It's John chapter 20, verse 21. Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so also I am sending you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld." It's interesting, in this encounter with the risen Christ, the disciples are being told three very important things. One is, as the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. In other words, as the mission has been completed by me, now I'm entrusting that mission to you. I'm going to speak more about that in just a few moments. But then, secondly, Jesus breathed upon them, and he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Even that word "receive" is significant, because in the Greek language, that word "receive" means to actively embrace. In other words, I'm giving it to you, and you need to open your arms and actively embrace what I'm giving to you. Jesus says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." I want you to actively embrace that. Where have we heard that before, by the way? That breathing of God. Look at this. Way back, book of Genesis, very beginning of the Bible, chapter 2, verse 7. "Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life." And so, just as with the creation of the human race, there was the breath of God, so now, with the recreation of the human race, there's the breath of God. And then there's a primary responsibility that's going to be given, and it helps us understand the third part of what Jesus just said. To Adam, it was said, "Be fruitful and multiply." To the apostles, to the disciples, it's being said that you're going to have the authority to let someone know if they've been forgiven. If they humbly ask for forgiveness, you can say, "Yes, you're now right with God. You've been reconciled to God," which is a powerful way of saying, "Be fruitful and multiply." So the mission remains the same. And Jesus also said to them in the book of Acts, this is the history of the early church, chapter 1, verse 8, he said, "You will receive power and ability when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses to tell people about me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and even to the ends of the earth." And so they're excited about this, and Jesus is after the 40th day, he ascends to the right hand of the Father. They see him leave. An angel says he's going to return just the way you saw him leave. But he had told them to wait for the power, wait for the promise of the Father. It's going to come upon you. And so they took that very seriously, and they went to Jerusalem, and they were waiting in a room that they had prepared for this. We just typically today call it the upper room. And the disciples are gathered together, many other believers, over 100, are gathered together waiting. And what are they doing? For 10 days, they're praying, they're fasting, they're seeking God, they're worshiping, they're praising, but they're tarrying, they're waiting upon God. Something that we American Christians have a hard time doing. That sense of be still and know that I am God and wait for the promise to happen, because it's coming. And on the 10th day, which is now 50 days after the the cross 50 days, which is now on the day of Pentecost, we find these words. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place, and suddenly there was a sound from heaven, like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. This went right into a powerful evangelistic service. Thousands of those who were nearby come to know Christ. The first generation of believers received power to bring the gospel, the good news, to their generation. But this is what I wanted you to get. They fully embraced the work of the Holy Spirit. I would suggest that every morning when you wake up, you say, "Good morning, Holy Spirit. What are we doing today? What's the mission today? What do you want me to do today? How are you empowering me today to accomplish and continue the work of Jesus Christ? What is it that I'm supposed to be doing today?" They fully embraced this work, and the result was, of course, the incredible spread of the gospel throughout the Roman Empire. Now, they had a second reason for having this power from God, and it may not seem obvious at first, but they had a very powerful and personal testimony. You know, I've spoken with many people who say they're Christians over the years, and some I immediately resonate with. They talk about Christ. They have this testimony of how they came to know the Lord. And everybody's testimony is different. We're unique. God deals with us individually on a case-by-case basis. Isn't that good to know? He doesn't try to fit us into some mold. But he does deal with us, and we receive from him. And we want to be sent according to his word and according to his purpose. But then I'll have some that I might ask the question, you know, how did you come to know Christ? How did you become a follower of Christ? And they just give me a blank stare. They don't know what I'm talking about. Now, I'm not trying to be unkind or judgmental in any way whatsoever. But it is interesting that for them to be a Christian is maybe to be born in America or to be born in the family that they were born into. Mom and dad were Christians, or grandma and grandpa, or they went to church, and so because they went to church, that makes them a Christian. That's like going to McDonald's turns you into a hamburger, you know? It just doesn't work that way. But they just don't see it. They don't understand that yet, because they don't have that vibrant, life-changing personal testimony of a commitment to follow Jesus Christ. Repentance, being born of the Spirit. Well, right after this incredible event took place on the day of Pentecost, Peter began to preach the resurrection. Thousands came to faith in Christ, as I said a moment ago. Ultimately, both Peter and John, both apostles, are arrested. In fact, they're going to be arrested many times during the course of their lives and during the course of their ministry. But this was the first arrest. And they're arrested and taken before the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin is the ruling body of ancient Israel. The Sanhedrin would be like having the president, the Congress, the House and the Senate, and the Supreme Court all standing there in front of you, and you got to make your case. It's all everything combined, the high priest, the leadership, the ruling body, they're all there, and they bring Peter and John, and they say, "You're disrupting our city. You're disrupting our people. You must stop what you're doing." What did Peter and John do? They began to preach to the Sanhedrin. They began to share the good news. They shared the gospel. They shared the resurrection of Christ. They even said very boldly, "The one you crucified has risen, and we're preaching in his name." And they just wanted to get rid of Peter and John at this point. Probably wanted to kill them, but they weren't ready to do that. So they just ordered them to no longer speak in the name of Christ, to no longer mention Jesus. And we find their response in Acts chapter 4, verse 19. Peter says, "Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you and obey you rather than God, you must judge for yourselves. For we, on our part, cannot stop telling people about what we have seen and heard. That's the testimony of a first-generation Christian. That's the testimony of someone who says, I've had personal experience of walking with Christ. I cannot stop speaking about this. You can order me to stop talking, but I have to talk because it flows out of my heart. It's a part of who I am. I have to speak about Jesus and the resurrection. In fact, in the book of Revelation, we discover that even heaven declared of this first generation of Christians that they triumphed. We find this in Revelation 12, verse 11. They triumphed over the demonic, over Satan, by the blood of the Lamb. That's the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ. By the word of their testimony, they knew who they were, why they were here, and what God was doing in their lives. And they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. That is, they're willing to put it on the line, whatever it's going to cost. So the first generation, this much we know so far. They embrace the power of the Holy Spirit. They triumph over the demonic by maintaining their testimony, even in the midst of persecution. And the key, I think, is that they were very mission-minded. They embraced the mission. Now, the mission can be seen in two parts. Let me remind you of what the mission of Christ really is. In fact, I'll let the Lord himself remind you. One, today we call the Great Commission. And the Great Commission took place after the resurrection of Christ, after the 40 days of the Lord teaching, the risen Savior teaching disciples, apostles, anyone who would listen to him that were disciples. And then right before he is ascended to the right hand of the Father, he has this final message for his apostles. Matthew 28, verse 18. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." So the focus of this commission for the church is the authority of Christ. It's the authority part of the mission, and it's for the apostles, clearly, so they can teach disciples who will train disciples who will train disciples generation after generation, and they're going to be sent to all of the world. That word is a Greek word, ethnos, and it means a group of people. You could be sent to this community, to that town, to that neighborhood, to that nation, whatever it may be. And the purpose they were going to be sent was to make disciples, very specific, to train, to have disciplined, trained followers of Christ, baptizing them and teaching them all of the heart teaching. Not hard, there's hard teachings, but the heart, the things that change your heart from Jesus. That's a great commission. But then there's a great mandate. And the great mandate was a little different. Jesus, during his ministry, before his arrest, visited many people, and he had been invited into someone's home. They gave a great party, a great banquet. It was filled with some of the rich people from the community, some of the religious leaders. And Jesus, looking around, saw that, you know, these were all the people that were very well off, very religiously connected, but it seemed like a whole segment of the population had been ignored or left out. And so we find in Luke chapter 14, verse 12, these words. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors." In other words, don't just invite them. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. And then he told a story about this, and at the end of the story, he says, "Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full." It's a great mandate. In the commission of Christ, he spoke about authority, the authority that he has to speak into the lives of his apostles and the disciples generation after generation. In the mandate, it's the compassion part of the mission, the heart aspect of it. With the commission, it's the apostles and the leadership that will continue from generation to generation. But for the mandate, it's the house, everybody who lives in the house. It's the church, it's the family, it's all of those who gather in the name of Jesus. For the commission, it's going to the ethnos, the world, wherever you may be sent. But for the mandate, it's going to those who are poor or those who are affected by disabilities who could often be overlooked. With the commission, it's to the disciples and training disciples. But for the mandate, it's compassionately encouraging people with disabilities or those who are not well off to trust in Christ and come into the fellowship of those who have faith in him. So we have a couple of things that have happened so far. We have a first generation of Christians. They're ready to take hold of this commission, take hold of this mandate. Who are they? These are those who had a personal encounter with Christ. They're now empowered by the Holy Spirit. They're ready to move forward and continue the mission of the Messiah. There's one little problem, and that's religious persecution and Roman occupation. You know, in Jerusalem, we have state-sponsored religious persecution. Most of you in this room, if not all of you, have never experienced such a thing, where the religious part of the state that is organized by the state and embraced by the state and only allowed by the state, will that religious part will stop you because you are disruptors of the religious establishment. And they can stop you and try to stop you legally because the state itself it's a state-sponsored persecution. That means there are no laws you can appeal to, no courts you can go to. You can simply be killed or put in prison. We have thousands upon thousands of believers around the world right now in prisons because they live and share their faith in countries where the same thing is happening. I'm going to share some of their stories with you in the weeks to come. Other than John, the Apostle John, all of the other apostles are eventually going to be martyred. That's a nice religious term for they're going to be killed for preaching the resurrection of Christ, for loving people and bringing good news to them. They're going to lose their lives. This first generation of Christians had to have great faith to take hold of what had been promised. And in spite of the persecution, the church grew in Jerusalem and ultimately throughout the Roman Empire all the way to the Poconos. In fact, there was one town that they were persecuting this young church, and they appealed to the police. And they said, you can find this in Acts chapter 17, says, those Christians, those people, those disruptors who have turned the world upside down, they've come here too. Can't you do something about these people? Oh, that somebody would say that about me. That they just say, that disruptor, that pastor, that person who preaches Jesus and the resurrection of Christ, he's now come in here. And I pray they would say that about you too. Because there's a demonic opposition to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the demonic is still active in our own generation. You know, earlier in this series, I quoted someone named Oswald Chambers, an amazing person, and his writing have blessed millions and millions of believers over the years. In fact, he never wrote anything. He just taught and preached, and his wife would write down a lot of the things he said, and eventually they got published as books. And I'm still waiting for people to write down the things I'm saying if I ever say anything that's worth writing down, you know. But Oswald Chambers definitely did, and here's one of those things. He said, Satan does not come to us on the premise of tempting us to sin, but on the premise of shifting our point of view. And only the Spirit of God can detect this as a temptation of the devil. Now, you got to think about that for a minute.
For example, perhaps the love and commitment of the next generation after this first generation, the next generation, future generations of Christians, maybe that love and commitment's going to grow cold. Maybe it's going to be replaced with the worries of the present day. We see the apostles knew something about this. They knew that this was a possibility, so they issued a challenge to the first generation of Christians, a challenge that they wanted them to pass along from generation to generation thereafter. And it was a challenge to stay faithful to the call of God. Now, I want you to get this. It's easy to miss it. The letters in the New Testament, sometimes we call them epistles, but they're simply letters written to the first generation Christians. In fact, they were all written to first generation Christians, especially those by the apostles James and Peter and Paul. Now, there's a couple of others I'll mention at the end who were written to the next generation Christian. And the purpose of these letters was to remind the believers of what these apostles knew to be true. They were calling them to continue in the mission and the power of the Holy Spirit. They tried to answer some of their questions as well, show them how Jesus as Messiah fulfilled so many of the great prophecies in the Old Testament, and how really the old covenant concealed was now the new covenant revealed. And that things had come to a place where you could understand how the pieces fit together. For example, James said to the church, James chapter 1, verse 2, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." By the way, that's your memory verse today. For those of you who are taking on that challenge of memorizing scripture, you can pick up a card on the way out that will have that verse on it from the New International Version. But this is one of the first verses I ever memorized as a brand new Christian. It was an amazing thing for someone to say to me that I should be rejoicing, I should be thankful whenever I face difficulties. I mean, think about that. That's a revolutionary concept. And not only that, but there was a reason for it, because it's going to test my faith. It's going to challenge me. And that testing of my faith is going to create within me something called endurance, perseverance. I'm going to continue to move forward. And as I continue to persevere, I begin to see how God's plan is unfolding. And I begin to mature as a follower of Christ. And I become more complete, lacking nothing. Just there is the heart of what it is to grow as a follower of Christ. I encourage you to memorize it. James went on to say in verse 5, "If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you." So often we come to a point in our lives where we hit a stop and we're not sure how to proceed. Whatever the challenge looks like, it seems like a mountain too big to climb or a river too wide to cross, and we do everything we can other than ask God for wisdom. Come on. Other than just stop and hear the Lord's voice say, "Be still and know that I am God. Ask of me what you want. I'll give you wisdom. I'll help you to see through this to what I'm doing." Now, there's so much more that James said I would love to talk about, but I want to talk for a moment about Peter. Peter's letters challenged the first generation of Christians to walk close with God, but most importantly, to live out the mission of Christ and really to do good in every possible way, whether it's to other believers or to those that you don't know, even those who might not like you and appreciate the life that is within you in Christ. But to do good to people, with that in mind, look at this, what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 13. He says, "Who is going to harm you if you're eager to do good?" I wish he ended right there. But he goes on to say, "But even if you should suffer what is right, you are blessed, Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. And always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience before God. It's a fascinating thing that Peter is saying to first-generation Christians. Says, you might suffer for doing right. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but I bet many of you have experienced that already as followers of Christ, where you tried to do the right thing, the good thing, the loving thing, the compassionate thing, the merciful thing, and somehow, somewhere, in some fashion, it got thrown back at you, and you feel like you're being injured for trying to do the right thing and to love people. Peter says, don't fear threats of mere people. Just keep Jesus as the center of your life. But he goes on to say, but be prepared. And this is where I think the church in America falls short. Be prepared to give an answer for the hope that is within you. If someone asks you the question, why are you a Christian? Explain the cross. Explain the resurrection. What is the good news? Share your testimony, your story of how your life was changed and transformed. And do it simply and lovingly. And do it compassionately with gentleness and respect, keeping your conscience clear with God. But Peter also warned first-generation Christians that demonic attacks will come. And they'll come upon anyone within the church. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, he said, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. This is an interesting thing, and it's a secret. Many people don't understand it. But if you're a first-generation Christian, that means you're not relying on someone else's faith, or you just go to church from time, but you're a first-generation. That means you have experienced the power of God. You've welcomed the Holy Spirit into your life. You're walking with God day in and day out. You're not perfect, but God is perfecting you. Does that make sense? There's a work in process. You're his son. You're his daughter. He says, of such people, wherever you may be around the world, there's potential for suffering and persecution. But the secret is that next generation and other generations who just see these things as stories, and maybe they go to church because some relative did, or, I'm this and I'll always be that, or I go, yeah, there's no persecution in their lives because they fit beautifully in with the culture around them. You cannot distinguish them from their neighbors or anyone else who doesn't know the Lord, other than from time to time they may show up at a church on a Sunday morning. This is what Peter's talking about. I'd like to say a lot more from Peter. Read it on your own. But Paul had some things to say as well, because he wanted to explain the fullness of the gospel message. In fact, there's a letter that he wrote to the Roman church. Today we just call it the letter of Romans, or the epistle of Romans. And it's, you could call it the gospel of Paul, because it lays out the entire gospel from sin, salvation, sanctification, sovereignty of God, and service. It lays out the entire message of the good news of Jesus Christ. Powerful, powerful book of the Bible. Simply a letter that he wrote to the church at Rome. There's also the book of Hebrews, which I'm one of those who think Paul wrote it, but I can't prove it because it's not designated as a letter from Paul. And it lays out the high priesthood and Melchizedek and what was going on with the priesthood in the Old Testament with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and then the priesthood under Moses, and how it's all fulfilled. The greater covenant and the eternal priesthood in Christ. Powerful. But he also wanted to talk to first generation Christians about how to live this life. So most of Paul's letters, if not all of them, are speaking about this very thing. There's so much there that what I decided to do this morning is just say one thing that Paul said and share it with you, because he planted a church in a little coastal town called Ephesus. It's still there today, the town and the church. And he became the first pastor of that church. He pastored the church for 3 years. And eventually he called together the elders of the church, and he had to speak to them. What he was going to say was goodbye. He felt that God was leading him forward, and it was a very scary moment because this was going to be the end of all of Paul's missionary journeys. And we find it in Acts chapter 20, verse 17. He calls these Ephesian elders and leaders together. He says, "You know how I lived the whole time I was with you, from the first day I came into the province of Asia. I served the Lord with great humility and with tears, and in the midst of severe testing, you know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must," and here's the message, "turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus." That's the message that is rarely preached in many American pulpits today. That we start our journey in Christ with repentance, with humility, with breaking, with honesty and transparency before God. Before that, we know nothing. Before that, we simply have religion. And Paul was prepared to now travel back to Jerusalem. He says, I'm getting ready to go on this journey. I'm getting ready to leave. And there was a prophecy over Paul, where it said, you're going to be arrested in Jerusalem. You're going to be bound in chains. Don't go. And Paul said, even if I get bound in chains, I have to go. God's told me I'm going to Jerusalem to preach the gospel there. And he preached the gospel, and he was arrested, and he was put in prison for witnessing about Jesus. And he continued to witness at Jesus for years in prisons and dungeons with trials before governors and religious leaders. This continued. Eventually, it took him all the way to Imperial Rome, where he also was imprisoned but continued to preach the message of Christ. Even some in Caesar's own household became followers of Christ. And it was there, some years later, that he himself would be martyred in Rome. So he goes on to say to the elders from Ephesus, "Now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again." He had this sense of what was about to happen. "Therefore I declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of any of you." I'll come back to that. "For I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood." Innocent of the blood of all of you. He's taking them back to something that was prophetically said by the prophet Ezekiel. You can look it up later, chapter 3. Where God says to the prophet, if you warn people, if you give them the whole message that I'm giving to you, their blood will not be on your hands. But if you fail to tell them what I'm telling you to tell them, then I hold you responsible for their loss. And Paul is saying, I'm innocent of your blood because I gave you the whole gospel. I gave you the whole message. And we have to ask ourselves, have we given the whole message to our neighbors, to our relatives, to our loved ones, to our co-workers, to that boss who, if you were to speak to, you might lose your job? I'm not trying to make anyone feel guilty or uncomfortable. I'm just saying the first generation Christians lay it on the line. And decisions need to be made about how we're going to live this life. He proclaimed the whole will of God. And then he says, keep watch, because you should do the same. Be shepherds of the church of God, which Jesus purchased with his own blood. There's an allusion to the Passover again. And then almost prophetically, Paul concludes, I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. This wasn't just an intellectual exercise for the apostle. This was his heart given to those that he's ministering the life of Christ to. And then the apostle says goodbye. And in a sense, he's saying goodbye to the whole first generation church. I know it's just these elders in Ephesus, but in a sense, it's drawing to a close. It's drawing to a close. And we find these words. When Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them most was his statement that they would never see his face again. And then they accompanied him to the ship. And in this way, we actually have a transition between the first generation of believers and the generations that would come after, all the way to this present generation that we've been born into. Now, next week, we're going to look at two authors in the New Testament. There's only two who wrote primarily for the generations that never saw Jesus. And in a sense, that's you and me. They knew nothing of Jerusalem. They never met any of the apostles. The great events that took place, the cross of Christ and the resurrection of Christ, they were becoming simple stories. So we want to understand the difference between the fire of a first-generation believer and what can happen in the next generation and thereafter. Next week's message will sum up the series, put all these pieces together. I hope you will be here for that message. I'm going to ask the band to come up. Let me just review what I've said today. We know a little bit more now about what it is to be a first-generation Christian. Look at it this way. They embraced the power of God through the Holy Spirit. They received, they eagerly embraced the Holy Spirit. They said, Lord, have your way in my life. And they desired to live up to their testimony of faith, even in the midst of persecution. They took hold of the Lord's great commission as well as his great mandate, the commission to go into all the world and make disciples, the mandate to not forget to reach out to the poor and those affected by disabilities. And even when there was state-sponsored persecution, the church grew. And finally, leaders like James and Peter and the Apostle Paul, they warned the young church that the next generation of Christians would not only face persecution, but a far more subtle attack. And it's the same one that we face today. I'll talk about that next week. Let me close with this quote. J.B. Phillips wrote many great books, but one thing he did was he translated the New Testament into modern English. He's one of the first to do it many, many years ago. Took a lot of flack for it, actually. But it's a powerful translation, and if you buy it or purchase it, I think you'll enjoy reading it as a fresh understanding of the New Testament. But as he was translating the Greek into English to try to help his youth, really initially it was for his youth, and then ultimately the whole church to really grab a hold of the words of the scriptures of the New Testament, they grabbed him. That has a way of happening. And he began to imagine what it would have been like to be amongst those first generation Christians, and he wrote these words. We need to remember that these letters were written and the lives they indicate were led against a background of paganism. There were no churches, no Sundays, no books about the faith. Slavery, sexual immorality, cruelty, callousness to human suffering, and a low standard of public opinion were universal. Traveling and communications were chancy and perilous. Most people were illiterate. Many Christians today talk about the difficulties of our times as though we should have to wait for better ones before the Christian faith can take root. It is heartening to remember that this faith took root and flourished amazingly in conditions that would have killed anything less vital in a matter of weeks. These early Christians were on fire with the conviction that they had become, through Christ, literally sons and daughters of God. They were pioneers of a new humanity, founders of a new kingdom. They still speak to us across the centuries. Perhaps if we believed what they believed, we might achieve what they achieved. A powerful challenge. Father, we come before you in the name of your Son, Jesus. And we receive this challenge across the decades from our dear brother, but also from the apostles so many years earlier, that challenge us to live as first-generation followers of Christ, to embrace the fullness of the Holy Spirit, to open ourselves completely to the work of the mission of Christ, to say that we're going to seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, knowing that all these other things that we are otherwise worrying about shall be added unto us anyhow through the grace and goodness of your love and by your hand. And so, Father, right now we submit ourselves to your inspection. We pray that your Holy Spirit would look into our hearts in a new and fresh way, and that we would be aware that as you look into us, that perhaps we would see ourselves honestly. And in doing so, we would recognize whether or not we would pass the test. Are we first-generation believers? Are we on fire with the supernatural intervention of your Son, Jesus, and the work of God in our lives and in this world? Lord, are we your hand extended? Where we go, can we speak peace? Do we hear your voice within us saying, go to the right or go to the left? Do we make decisions based on your wisdom? Do we face trials and challenges with joy, knowing that the testing of our faith produces endurance? And we want to let that endurance have its full work in our lives so we'll be complete and mature followers of Christ. Is this real for us? Are we your sons? Are we your daughters? Or are we just going to church from time to time? Father, speak into our hearts today. Don't let this message fall on hard soil, but soil that's prepared to receive it so that there will be a harvest. And Father, if there's even one person here who would say, that's just not me, but I want it to be me. I want to be that first generation Christian on fire with the Spirit of God. If that's you, pray with me. And say, God, I give my life to you. I give my heart to you. I receive Jesus at the very center of my being. And I ask you to forgive me because I haven't paid attention to your call on my life. And I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit. Empower me to accomplish your will and your purpose and your plan. And I thank you for it. I trust you for it. And I ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise God. First generation Christians. Now, before the band plays and we receive the offering, I'd love you to take the Connect card out again, wave it at me a little bit. Because on the back, I've got some stuff there that, it changes every week. But the most important thing is always the first thing. I've made a decision to follow Christ. If that's you, let us know. We want to help you. We have things we'll send you. We want to support you in any way we can. You have this week's memory card. You have, for the scripture from James chapter 1, 2 through 4. You have which you can pick up on the way out. Discussion questions, which we create every week fresh. And if you're just tossing out that bulletin, well, God bless you. But if you take that and just spend a little time with family or friends or a small group of Christians and talk about it, I think God will richly reward you. You see the membership lunch is coming up. The Bible discussion group is starting. My class on intercession will be coming next month. So many things. Prayer requests. Make sure we get your pictures when you get to go into the database so we can pray over you and look at you as we're praying for you. If you're visiting for the first time today, God bless you. I love you. We love you here at Innovation Church. Pastors and deacons love you. Listen, let us know it's your first time visit. Put that in the bucket when we take an offering in just a moment. And when you do, on the way out, we have a book. It's a gift for you. I choose these books very specifically and strategically. This one's great. You're going to love it. It's called More Than a Carpenter, and it describes who Jesus really is. It's written by Josh McDowell, and we want you to have it. That's a gift for you. Keep in mind, after the buckets have passed, we're going to stand together and worship the Lord. The altars will be open for prayer. Some of our leaders will come up and be available to pray with you. We have the Lord's Supper up here as well. Let's pray over this offering. Father, we thank you for the time we've had together here this morning. We're not done, Lord. Some very important work is yet to happen as the band plays, as we respond to your invitation, as we come up for prayer, as we come to the altar, whatever it is, Lord, to get a hold of our lives, let it happen now. And we receive the offering as well. We pray that you would bless it and honor it and let it accomplish that which you have raised it up for. And we pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Thank you.
Have a great day, church. We'll